We arrived at 1980s in our discussions, 1980s, 90s, 20s. Today we are going to go a little bit back earlier in time and discuss one philosopher who began to be quite influential, especially in connection with the spread of postmodern thinking, or if you like, postmodern conditions, or whatever you like to call our recent times. Okay, Martin Heidegger, a German philosopher. Is it appropriate to call it some ambiguous philosopher or what? I don't know, I'm not sure. But it's certain that it's quite difficult to penetrate his discussions. But we are going to give it effort. Bunu takalım. Gömleğinizin cebine
takılabilirsiniz hocam.
Cebim. Doğru, daha önce de bir kere söylemiştim. Böyle bir acayip oluyor gibi de. Okay, so we are going to make an attempt anyway. And we are going to start with an interesting question. But before that, let me say that Heidegger's thinking had very close connections with Husserl's thinking. Actually, there was a beautiful statement over there. I was looking at it before coming to the class. Okay, the main thesis in Husserlian phenomenology. Let's start with it, okay? According to this, what Husserl called transcendentally reduced experience, okay, and the phenomenological application of the phenomenological method, actually, consists in the self-appearance and the self-exhibiting, the self-giving of objects themselves. That was the strange conclusion of the Husserlian phenomenology, aiming at establishing a solid ground for sciences and scientific knowledge, etc. Okay, now, let this be our starting point in for Heideggerian philosophy. Heidegger, even though never formally being a student of Husserl, he worked for a time very close with Husserl and distinguished himself among those who attached themselves to Husserl and Husserlian phenomenology in his gift, so to speak, or talent in practicing of this phenomenologically transcendentally reduced experience. Okay. Actually, as I said earlier, it requires practice. Okay, one cannot immediately penetrate into the nature of this transcendentally reduced experience. It requires sort of meditation, practice. So Heidegger was very successful in this, and later on diverted his ways from Husserl due to a shift in the major question. Okay, take a look at the quotation. What has been thought within Husserlian framework as that which gives itself away within this transcendentally reduced experience was the objects themselves. Okay. Now the question was, remember the tiny little schema. Now consciousness was intentionality, not something establishing a certain relationship, okay, between a subject perhaps and an object, but both of them remaining outside of this transcendentally reduced experience, simply because within this structure what shows itself or gives itself was the object for consciousness, which was different from what we may think as the real object. Okay, objects for consciousness. If I use a Kantian terminology, I would call this a phenomenon. You know? That which appears, shows itself, gives itself away within the structure of that experience. And what is What this experience consists, therefore, is nothing else than this object for consciousness and the acts of intentionality, which the total sum of which we refer by the term consciousness. Okay. As you can see, the surrounding world, according to Husserl, okay, of an individual human being, consists in this, not in these two. Okay. So what's at stake is not the real objects, not the real subject. Real subject never showing itself within the structure of experience. But here, these acts, as you can see, open up a field in which we find the world surrounding us. Okay. The world is there, not there, not there, but here within this. Okay. So Husserl's attention has been concentrated on the question of the objects, how objects come into this, how differently they may show themselves under different modalities of intentionality in relation to other things, etc., etc. Okay. Now Heidegger makes a twist in this question, okay, and rather asks the question, a strange question indeed, and I'm experiencing difficulties in expressing it. Okay. The question is actually this. Why there is something rather than nothing? Okay. Tackling with this question leads Heidegger to ask that famous question of being. Okay. So actually his entire thinking revolves around this question of being. What is this question of being? Why it turns out to be so important? It turns out to be so important because, for Heidegger at least, okay, the relationship of human being with the question of being turns out to be very important. Very important in the sense as to determine it is human being's destiny. Okay. Now there is a strange concept, destiny, here, okay, actually, which has been produced in its relation with historicity. Or historical, in German, which is geschichtlich, okay, geschichtlich, historical. On the other hand, however, this destiny, that term translated into English, is destiny, is geschick. Okay. So having very close connections with historicity, but presenting in Heideggerian thinking a kind of alternative to what we conceptualize as history and historicity. Okay. A kind of alternative whose difference we are going to try to see in the preceding discussions. Okay. So another beautiful passage comes from Plato. Actually, Heidegger takes this at the beginning of his famous book Being and Time, published in 1926, as far as I remember, as early as 1926. Now, the dialogue in Plato is something like this, okay? They were talking with others, as it is Socrates was talking with somebody, I don't remember whom right now. And Socrates suddenly stops in the middle of discussion and says the following, okay? He says, "For manifestly you have long been aware of what you mean when you use the expression being." Varlık in Turkish, as you know. Okay. "We, however, who used to think we understand it, have now become perplexed." Okay. we don't understand anything when you say this. Okay, that's actually that's the fate of if you talking about destiny. That's the fate of lots of words. Okay. Lots of words. You have to think without further pondering about them. We usually tend to think that we know. We are very familiar with their meanings. Okay. But when you start really seriously thinking about them, we find out that actually we don't know what they mean, okay, what they stand for. We don't know. For instance, take the word, quite familiar word, knowledge. Okay. Very often we use that term. We say each other, our own selves, that we know this or that. Okay, in different contexts, in different senses, we use the term. But really, seriously, when it comes to think about what do we mean by when we say we know this or that, we don't know what it means. Okay. This is the same with the term this being. Okay, we use that word quite often in our lives. Şu var, kalem var, sen var mısın, yok musun, etc. Lots of talking. Okay. But what do we really mean by it? Is the very question Heidegger now turns his face, turns his thinking. Okay. And it appears that it turns out to be quite a difficult question. But one thing we can understand, but perhaps this constitutes our starting point. Okay, this is not the question of Heideggerensis. This is not the question of beings. Okay. This is not the question of beings, these objects, after which a Husserlian phenomenology was running. Okay, but rather, how these things, okay, how these things are said to be, okay, this is the question. How these things are said to be, in what sense they are said to be, and actually, if our source here, as far as I remember, it was from John's book, okay, gives an example. Even though I am quite afraid of examples in the discussion of such matters, maybe it will be helpful for you to understand what's meant by this. Okay, remember that Platonic discussion about knowledge. Okay, we come to know things. The parable of the sun. You know, the sun sheds its light on things. So under this light, we come to see things, know things. Okay, so that was maybe helpful example. Okay, what's at stake is no longer in Heideggerian thinking those things, but that very light through the medium of which we come to see things, or if you like, let's use a closer language to Heidegger's. Okay, that things give themselves away to us. Okay. So it's that medium actually. And practically speaking, this medium does not stand by itself. Okay, the difficulty of conducting an analysis upon this medium is this: it does not present itself as if it is something separated in our example from the things themselves, from the being of the things themselves. Okay. But if you put the question in such a way, maybe therefore the example is somehow misleading. Okay, the sun had been thought as the source of light, so light turns out to be another thing which can be analyzed. Okay. However, being is not that. Okay, being is always comes into presence, or if you like, okay, in connection with some certain being. Okay, so the being of something. Okay. Now this is the philosophical expression, most easiest, ordinary way of expressing it, saying that something is. Okay. Say the table is. It is this is what's at stake here. Okay. The table is, say, green or beautiful. So perhaps this starting point would also be misleading, simply because you usually tend to think about language as if it's a human instrument. Okay. Now, in Heideggerian context, language is not that. Okay, first of all, language is the medium through which being speaks, according to him. Okay. But before entering into these questions, let's concentrate on this. Okay. As you can see, nobody constructs a statement consisting only of one component, is. Nobody says is. Okay. So is something which does not stand alone by itself. Okay. Always in connection with the others, and turn out to be a very interesting, simply because the whole question lies in this. And the forgetfulness of the question of being is especially related with the forgetfulness of this role of is here, and see it as simply a kind of copula. Just like Immanuel Kant did once upon a time. Okay, there's a half-page writing of Kant here on this question of is, and he simply there says that okay, the is does not contribute anything at all, neither to the subject of the predicate proposition, nor the predicate. Okay, so actually, what I've written here is known as a proposition, okay? A statement I have written here. A statement is composed of several, this is the most basic of this form of the statements, you know, three components here. And as you can see, the table is the subject of the statement, and this is the predicate, okay, adjective if you like, that characterizes that particular table in this state. Okay. The table, it says, is green. Okay. And it's true as is, the greenness and the table had been connected with each other. Therefore, it only connects these two things together, and therefore it's called copula, contributing neither to this one nor to that one. Okay. But what happens if I write, omit the predicate, for instance, here, and if I write down there on the board, the table is. Do we think that such a half statement has any meaning? Do you see any meaning in this? Saying the table is. For instance, try to say it in Turkish. Masadır. What does it mean? Does it mean anything at all? Okay. Masa yeşildir is a fine, beautiful statement. Okay. Connecting masa and yeşil together, so allowing you to identify, okay, that green table and differentiate it from that yellow table or whatever. Okay. So two things had been associated. Yeah, however, okay. This has a strange function. Okay. Even though I write this form, as you can see, it has a strange kind of meaning. Masadır. What does it mean? That something is or dır. What does it mean? That's the question Heidegger deals with here. Okay. So I hope it gives you a sense. Okay. And Heidegger says that since the time of the pre-Socratics, at one source he says that it started with Plato, and at another source it started by saying that it started with Aristotle. But finally, it seems that he has made his decision by telling us that it started all with Socrates himself. Okay. No further ado about it, that the forgetfulness of being in a rather accumulative process comes to our times and culminates in Cartesian example, showing that the modern man has almost completely forgotten that question of being, okay, no longer being able to pose that question and no longer being able to understand what that question means. Okay. this he's gonna talk about as the oblivion of being, okay, or forgetfulness of being. Okay, we have forgotten that question and delved into our busyness, so to speak, or our busy existence in dealing with the objects. Okay. Actually, by being, what is meant? The possibility of an object coming to be. Okay, that's actually coming to be, or presence. We may use different terms according to different periods in which Heidegger adopts different terminologies. Okay, the possibility of a certain somethings being here. Where? We don't know either as well. Okay, we were talking about the surrounding world here. And don't forget, and this relationship in Husserlian phenomenology was primarily a relationship of knowledge. So therefore, if I pose the question, if I characterize that arrow here as the problem of knowledge, it is not surprising that that entity, actually, all the arrows are thought to emanate from, therefore constituting the world, okay, turns out to be consciousness, right? Simply because knowledge is already related with being aware of the existence of things. What did I say? Existence of things. Okay, what do I imply by this term? What is the existence of things? It's actually closely related with this is. Okay, their being somewhere, their being here, here where we can be aware of their being here. Okay, therefore Heidegger take, actually he says that modern metaphysics was concerned, occupied itself with the question of the objects, therefore has to be overcome. A new kind of metaphysics or philosophy should be adopted, aiming at that very question of being. Okay? It seems to be quite an essential and important question for Heidegger. Okay? Now, let me read how Heidegger reacts to that observation done by Socrates about the perplexity. Okay? We don't know about what being means, and so on. Okay? Heidegger writes, "Do we in our time have any answer to the question of what we really mean by the word being? Not at all. So it's fitting that we should raise anew the question of the meaning of being. But are we nowadays even perplexed at our inability to understand the expression being? Not at all. Okay. So first of all, we must reawaken an understanding for the meaning of this question. Our aim in the following treatise is to work out the question of the meaning of being and to do so concretely." Okay. This treatise is Being and Time. Okay. So this is just the introductory part of this question. Okay. And as for the forgetfulness of modern man with regard to that question, he writes the following at the same place. And with regard to its importance, of course. "What if the absence of this involvement and the oblivion of this absence determined the entire modern age?" So therefore, out of this question, actually, Heidegger would gradually turn into a very interesting and deep critic of modernity, okay? "What if the absence of being abandoned man more and more exclusively to beings, leaving him forsaken and far from any involvement of being in his nature, while this forsakenness itself remains veiled? What if this, if this were the case, and had been the case for a long time now, what if there were signs that this oblivion will become still more decisive in the future?" Okay. Thus, everything depends on this. The thinking which is posited by beings as such, and therefore representational and illuminating in that way, must be supplanted by a different kind of thinking which is brought to pass by being itself and therefore responsive to being. Actually, out of the expression, you already sensed that, okay, things are not good right now and does not show any sign for improvement for the future as well. And this, according to Heidegger, is the result of man's forgetfulness of the question of being. Okay, therefore, this question needs to be reawakened. Okay. So, to be able to do so, however, his starting point of analysis turns out to be something he calls Dasein. Sometimes written together, sometimes with a dash in between. Okay. In its ordinary German usage, the term Dasein, usually translated as existence. Okay. For instance, when we are saying Dasein of the existence of this or that, for instance, very famous phrase, Dasein, the existence of God, for instance, Dasein des Gottes. Okay, so that's the expression. Sandalyenin varlığından bahsediyorum derken, I use the term Dasein. Okay, so it's not something special in it actually, and it has been very often used, either both in ordinary language and in technical philosophical language, etc. Okay, but he takes this world and replaces this, let me say so, okay, replaces this with what has been known up until that time with the term subject. Okay, so actually when we are going to talk about Dasein, we are talking about Heideggerian alternative to modern conceptualization of this subject. Okay. Actually, subject itself is a very strange term. As we have seen in earlier discussions, say in Foucault as well as some others, actually it originates in ancient Greek and it doesn't mean anything else than that which lays beneath. Okay, its meaning is this, sub, you know, the sub part of the subject, that prefix, where was that? That means, refers to something beneath, okay, under. And this ject, actually, modern form of Latin iectum, meaning lays, okay, so sub iectum refers to that which lays beneath. Heidegger prefers to translate it as gathering ground. It's a beautiful translation, if you like. You ask me. And in that sense, as you can see, it has nothing to do what we understand usually by the term subject in any given modern context. Okay, but when we use in modern context the term subject, what comes to our mind, first of all, is a human being, right? When we are talking about the subject, we are talking about a human, okay? Primarily, not always necessarily, and with two important qualifications, you know, free will and reason. This is the subject, as we understand the term, within the modern context. So, due to these misleading conceptualizations, he leaves the term subject to modern understanding. Okay, you can have it. Okay. Now I'm bringing into picture another concept. I'll carry this something, this ordinary world, to a status of a very interesting concept, the existence. This time, it's not, don't you think it's strange? Now from then on within the framework of Heideggerian thinking, when we are referring to Dasein, we are going to use the term existence itself. Okay, this means existence. But within the Heideggerian framework, this is why it's used with that dash sometimes, okay, to be able to show that other meaning. Okay, it's a compound word, as you can see, okay, consisting of a part, da and sein. Okay, da means there. Sein means being. Okay. So, if you translate this, what we are talking about as the human being, okay, is nothing else than being there. Okay. The human being is that being there. So we were talking about where. Okay. For instance, when I am using this form, the table is this world, okay, even though it does not connect table with any special peculiarity or predicate or adjective, whatever, okay, it locates the table there, okay, within there. It makes the table be there, okay. So it, out of this, making the table be there, it turns out to be that it acquires it. Very interesting significance of its own. Okay. So the table is where? The table is there, where Dasein is. Okay. Being there. Dasein itself turns out to be a being there. Now, this is a strange thing, as you can see, but we have seen there were lots of discussions actually preparing, paving the way for this conclusion. Take a look at Tusserli and Shemon. The possibility of being there has already been drawn here, as you can see. Okay. But according to one single problematic, we should add, okay, in Kant as well, there it was there. It was possible to draw a circle on the board, as you may remember, okay, as the field of all possibility of appearances, and so on. Okay. So it is this. But as you may remember as well, the primary question that enabled them to draw this world, this being theirs, was knowledge. Therefore, the entity produced by this relationality of knowledge was nothing else than the consciousness, the state of our own again, being aware. Now, however, the formulation has been slightly modified. We are no longer talking about being aware, but we are talking about being there. Okay, and according to Heidegger, therefore, the question of knowledge, the problem of understanding the world, turns out to be only one. Just like, remember, there were very many possibilities of the for the modalities of intentionality. Actually, it was already there, that in Husserlian thinking that that intentionality assumes the form of knowing was one of the possibilities, just one of the possibilities. Loving, hating, remembering, and other modalities had already been at place there. But knowing had been given a special priority in relation to this. Okay. Therefore, this had turned out to be still characterized by knowing. Now, we just simply take this priority attributed to knowing away. That's all. Okay. What remains behind? You know, one of the basic divisions within the Western tradition of thinking was between willing and knowing. So therefore, it was not accidental that I'll bring these two together as the primary characteristics of the modern subject. As you can see, the first item is related with willing, or if you like, the form assumed by willing within the context of modern subjectivity. And the other one, again, reason, knowing, or intellect, the question of the intellect. Okay. So again, here. And Heidegger appears by taking away that privilege of knowing away, actually appears to shift it towards the direction of willing. Therefore, his primary concern, or the whole possibility of opening up this world, which is Dasein, okay? And another important difference I'll point out a few moments later, okay, between the subject and Dasein, which is Dasein, lays in the very possibility of willing. Okay? So the arrow here, which has been used in showing the meaning of intentionality here, okay, refers to that willing. Therefore, Heidegger would base his analysis or this opening up not upon knowing, but Sorge, or if you like, care in English. Okay. So Dasein is that peculiar being, in other words, that cares about itself and about the world and about being. Okay. So Dasein is different from other beings in this care. Okay. So therefore the other beings cannot have any world, but Dasein has. Okay. The whole opening up this surrounding world actually is based upon this care, this concern of Dasein with regard to its own existence and the existence of the world. Okay. Now it is this care, so to speak, that opens up the world. In other words, it's because I am concerned myself and because I am concerned about the surrounding world, this surrounding world comes to presence. And this is about, yes, the question of being. Okay. Not the question of the things, but the question of being. The worldliness of the world, or as Heidegger later uses the phrase, the wording of the word depends upon it. Okay. Otherwise, there is no word at all. Okay. Okay, this is an interesting analysis, curious something. Okay. Sometimes I wonder when I think about it. Okay. And sometimes it seems to me having its own difficulties simply because, as you know, this is another form, again, another form of anthropomorphic thinking. Okay. We are talking about a world at the center of which there stands Dasein. Or does it really stand? No, it does not stand. Okay. Dasein's existence in the world, as Heidegger would put it, being along with the world, okay, does not similar to subject's existence in the world. Okay. As you can see, and this was not accidental, when I multiplied the various modalities of intentionality and it is possible objects in the form of a circle, in the form of a circle, there appeared to be a center there. Okay. And that center, which is always outside of phenomenological transcendental reduction, okay, so therefore it's not inside in this, okay, creating a vacuum in the center, so to speak, okay, in relation to possibility of bringing it into consciousness, okay, creating a vacuum, okay, but standing at the center, the human subject is still at the center, as if it is separated from the rest of the world, facing the objects, the world being constituted of objects and the human subject facing the world. Okay. Yes, this way of looking at the problem posed the problem in a rather different way, different than the tradition. You know, traditionally speaking, at the beginning of discourse, for instance, we all came to think that we are here human beings, and the things are there, okay, other human beings, which we consider more or less equal to ourselves. Therefore, when we are referring to them, we use usually the term we, okay. That's implying that we are of the same genus, same type of being, okay. And the rest are a world composed of objects, you know, objects ready to be manipulated by our own selves. We are gonna go them and study them, okay? We are gonna report them, we are gonna try to modify their actions, so on and so forth, okay? They are the objects. We are the men of knowledge, and they are our objects. Now, however, the Heideggerian Dasein or the Heideggerian conceptualization, this is one of the basic and most important differences perhaps between Dasein and the subject. Dasein is nowhere, it is simply being there, and this being there opens up a field. It is not at a particular place in there, okay? It is, if you like, scattered all over the existence, okay? So, even the question of getting in touch with something turns out to be meaningless in Dasein's mode of being in the world, simply because Dasein is alongside with the world, okay? And this alongside with the world implies that Dasein is everywhere in this world, okay? Later on, Heidegger would use a specific term, okay? Earlier, it would use the European form, ecstasis. Later on, he would use the ancient Greek form, okay? With a dash in between again, ecstasis. It has been distributed all over the place, if you like. And it is this distribution, actually, and nothing else, distributed through its care, its concernful dealings with the things in the world, okay? Distributed through these concernful dealings. And what's interesting is that it's distributed all over the place, and this distribution is actually the very meaning of the it's being there, okay? Nothing else. Shall we have a break or continue? Let's have a break.